وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
Carrying on from where we were on, we alhamdulillah, with the blessing of Allah Azza wa Jalla, we spoke about Al-Imam al-Bukhari, Hayatuhu Shakhsiyya. We spoke about his personal life, right? And this is just a summary. Now we're going to go into his academic background, his Islamic knowledge that he had, rahimahullah ta'ala. The way we're going to start with that is, first of all, we're going to speak about طلبه للحديث ونبوغه فيه. How he sought the knowledge of hadith and how he went far into it. Let's touch on that, inshallah ta'ala. Al-Imam al-Bukhari was Warraq, his transcriber. We're going to keep going back to this man, Muhammad ibn Abi Hatim, a lot, because he wrote and transcribed a lot of what Bukhari said. Okay, he said, سَمِعْتُهُ يَقُولُ I heard Bukhari say, دَخَلْتُ بَلْخ I went into this place, بَلْخ فَسَأَلَنِي أَصْحَابُ الْحَدِيثِ The people of Hadith in بَلْخ, they requested from me, أَنْ أُمْلِيَ عَلَيْهِمْ to dictate for them. They said, Bukhari, we want you to dictate Hadith for us. And wallahi, brothers, these ulama were reading and they were quoting from where? In Hifdhi. My iPad switches off right now, class. The lecture's gonna be closed. I don't know what to do. Like in his imam, what would he do? Yumli riwayat wal asarif, all of it from his head. Rahimahullah. So he said that the people of Hadith in Balkh requested for me to dictate Hadith for them. From who, lakin? They said to me, how many scholars did you meet, Bukhari? And he said, I met 1,080. 1,080 scholars I met, and I took hadith from them. They said to him, narrate for us all of the hadith that you heard from each of those scholars. And then Bukhari said to them, you guys have the ability, you guys have the ability to be patient and to listen to all of those riwayat. And they said to him, yes, we do. فَأَمْلَى عَلَيْهِمْ He narrated for them, أَلْفُ حَدِيثٍ لِكُلِّ أَلْفِ شَخْصٍ He said, each person, I'm going to give you 1,000 of this, of just their narrations. There are 1,000 men, but each man, I'll give you how much from them? 1,000. Pay attention. That's all I will give you from each person. How much is the number that he gave them? Huh? 100,000 he gave them hadiths from min dhahri al-qalb, from the top of his head, with the sanad, and with each individual. This is 100,000. This one's 1,000, 1,000, 1,000, until he narrated 100,000 narration for them.
1,000,000.
Yeah? 1,000 times 1,000. 1,000,000 now. 1,000,000, sahih. Now it's 1,000,000. He narrated those all from what? From his memory, hifd. Okay? But Bukhari is counting the takrar, the repetition of a narration, even if the talk is different. It's a number for him.
So didn't it say that was the narration that he took 300,000
hadith
from memory?
No, he took 300,000 hadith from Imam Ahmad from memory.
From
Imam Ahmad from memory. Lakin, what did Iraqi say? He said, أول من صنف في الصحيح محمد وخص بالترجيح ومسلم بعد وبعض الغرب مع أبي علي فضلوا ذا لون فع ولم يعماه ولكن قلما عند ابن أخرم قد فاتهما ورد لكن قال يحيى البر لم يفت الخمسة إلا النزر وفيه ما فيه لقول الجعفي أحفظ منه عشرة ألف 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 means a million. He memorized a million hadith. And Imam al-Bukhari. But the counting, we're going to go to it later, the way that they counted. The way that they counted the hadith is not the way we're counting it. We're looking at one hadith of the Prophet, even if it comes in three different turuq or 50 different turuq, what do we say? It's just one hadith, right? No, this is a number. It's counted as a different hadith now. Because it came through another chain. Okay, we'll speak about that later. So this, what does it show us? The hifd and the memory of Al-Imam al-Bukhari. His Warraq also said, we're not going into memory, we're just talking about his talab al-ilm. His memory, we're going to come to inshallah in more details later. He's Warraq, Muhammad ibn Abi Hatim, and he said, سمعت هاني بن نضر, I heard هاني بن نضر say, كنا عند محمد بن إسماعيل, كنا عند محمد بن يوسف الفريابي. We were in the gathering of Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Firyabi. Okay? And this was where? In Sham. وكنا نتنزه. And we were just enjoying ourselves. No, we were tired, we seek knowledge, we did, we read hadith, memorized. We were relaxing, taking some time out. وكان محمد بن إسماعيل أسف الإمام محمد بن إسماعيل البخاري. He was with us. وكان لا يزاحمنا. He wouldn't busy himself and he wouldn't basically indulge in what we were doing. فما نحن فيه. He would not indulge in that which we were doing. بل يكب. But rather he would put his head down onto على العلم knowledge. This is a unique characteristics of a what? Student of knowledge. When other people are doing, he just chooses to leave them and do his what's important for him. So Imam al-Bukhari, when they were going in and talking, and these are people you have to understand, the beginning they were students of knowledge. They were memorizing, they were learning, they just maybe 10, 15 minutes, 20 minutes, they wanted to relax. We're not talking about people who just always relax. And even then, what did he do? Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala, he would turn away from that and he would not. He would not be with them. Also, he said, his Warraq said, وَسَمِعْتُهُ يَقُولُ I heard Bukhari say, لَمْ تَكُنْ كِتَابَتِ الْحَدِيثَ My writing of hadith was not كَمَا كَتَبَ هَؤُلَاءِ The way that these people wrote. He's talking about the other scholars of hadith. The way that they wrote hadith is like, we're not the same. I'm different. كُنْتُ إِذَا كَتَبْتُ I was one if I wrote عَنْ رَجُلٍ أَيْمَانٍ سَأَلْتُ عَنْ إِسْمِهِ I asked his name. What's your name? وَكُنْيَتِهِ I asked him his kunya. وَنَسَبِهِ I asked his lineage. وَعِلَّةِ الْحَدِيثِ I asked him the defect of this hadith. إِنْ كَانَ الرَّجُلَ فَهِمًا If the man knew and has understanding, I asked him, is there a hidden defect in the hadith? فَإِنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ If he didn't know, سَأَلْتُ أَنْ يُخْرِجَ لِي If he wasn't a person, I knew, did not have the knowledge of عِلَلُ الْحَدِيثِ I would say, okay, do me a favor. Bring me your asal, your original copy that you wrote the hadith on. And he said, I will then look at it. فَأَمَّا الْآخَرُونَ As for the other people who wrote the hadith, فَلَا يُبَالُونَ They never cared. مَا يَكْتُبُونَ وَلَا كَيْفَ يَكْتُبُونَ They never cared what they wrote and how they wrote it. This was another amazing thing about Imam Bukhari. And these information, brothers, is going to help us when we speak about the riwayat of Bukhari, when we speak about the sahih. It gives us understanding of this man, what he was. Okay? It helps us a lot to understand that. Abu Bakr al-A'yun, he said, سَمِعْنَا We heard. Abu Bakr ibn al-A'yun said, We heard from al-Imam al-Bukhari ala babi Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Firyabi wa huwa, and he was Bukhari at that time, Amrad. Amrad means no beard on his face. Like we were sitting down and taking hadiths from who? From al-Imam al-Bukhari, and he was what? He had no beard. قلت حافظ الحجر saying this. He said, كان السن البخاري Bukhari's age at that time was إذ ذاك بضعة عشرة سنة. He was only how many? بضعة عشرة سنة means between 13 and 19. That's how much Bukhari was. This أعين أبو بكر بن الأعين حافظ الحجر said, والأعين المذكور من أصحاب الإمام أحمد المشهورين. Abu Bakr ibn al-A'yuna is from the students of Imam Ahmed, rahimahullah ta'ala, and is well known. Are you with me, brothers? Wal-Firyabiyuna, Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Firyabi, who's dual in Bukhari, which he is narrating in front of now. He's min kibari shuyukh in Bukhari. He's from Bukhari's senior shuyukh. So he's talking in the gathering of his own teacher, Muhammad ibn Yusuf, Muhammad Ismail al-Bukhari, in the sitting and the door and the house of who? Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Firyabi. This is something powerful. This was what? Something powerful. Listen to this now. Ibn Tahir, he said, قدم البخاري بغداد سنة عشر ومئتين وعزم على المضي إلى عبد الرزاق. I mean, this is another powerful benefit. But before I go into this, something came to my mind before I forget it. Bukhari's Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salam al-Baykandi, rahimahullah. Muhammad ibn Salam al-Baykandi. He used to call Bukhari. Bukhari, come here. تعال أيها الفتى. ينظر فتى He said, you say to him, can you look at my book? My asal, I want you to check it for me. And Bukhari would check it. And whenever Bukhari would agree with the hadith, he would say, radiya al-fata, the boy agreed, the young boy agreed with my narration. If Bukhari says, I don't like this narration, it's wrong, get rid of it. He would say, lam yarda al-fata, the boy didn't agree with this. They used to use his memory as a muqabala. They used to use his memory. You know when manuscripts are being put together, scholars, what do they use? Different nusakhs, different copies to compare. Bukhari was a nuskha. He was a copy. They used to compare his memory with what was written for them. And if their memory, if what was written was wrong, they knew Bukhari was right, they were corrected. We're going to come to later, the students of Muhammad ibn Ali, rahimahullah, his students, they asked al-Imam al-Bukhari a hadith, and for the first time Bukhari looked and he said, la a'lam, la a'lam. I'm la adri, I don't know. They screamed, oh, Bukhari doesn't know the hadith. So they went to the Sheikh, they said, Sheikh, one of your hadith we told Bukhari, he said, I don't know it. And he said, hadith la ya'rifuhu al-Bukhari, falaysa bi hadith. A hadith that Bukhari doesn't know is not a hadith. Let's go back to this hadith. Let's check it. Bukhari doesn't know it. We need to check this hadith. This is how the scholars of that time looked at him. And they saw him. Rahimahullah ta'ala. Listen to this story. This is his seeking of knowledge. Al-Imam al-Bukhari, he came to Baghdad sanata ashri wa mi'atayn. The year what? 200 and? If we said Bukhari was born the year 194, 210, how old would he be? 16, right? He came to Baghdad. When he came to Baghdad, wa'azama, and he made a decision ala al-mudi to go to who? Ila Abdurrazzaq ibn Hammam San'ani. Imam Ahl Yemen. I'm going to go to Abdurrazzaq ibn Hammam San'ani. Abdurrazzaq ibn Hammam San'ani, Baghdad, where is it from Yemen? I'm going to go now. I'm going to go to Abdurrazzaq. When he made that decision, his teacher, Yahya ibn Ja'far al-Baykandiyu, said to him, Abdurrazzaq is dead. When he asked his teacher, he said, I want to go and I want to meet Abdurrazzaq ibn Hammam San'ani. I want to take from him. He said, he's dead. Mat Abdurrazzaq. After that, it became clear that he didn't die. فَسَمِعَ الْبُخَارِيُّ So it forced Bukhari to hear the hadith from who? Through Yahya ibn Ja'far al-Baykandi, or else he could have got it from Abdurrazzaq himself directly. Are you with me, brothers? Now his chain through Abdurrazzaq became longer. The scholars, they mentioned two reasons why the Sheikh said this. One, because the Sheikh, his teacher was not a liar. It was either he was trying to say that because he thought so. There was a news that spread that Abdurrazzaq died. That's one. Second reason is Abdurrazzaq ibn Hammam San'ani changed in the last stages of his life. Tashayyu' entered him. Are you with me? Mala ila at-tashayyu'. Tashayyu' entered him. And so what he was trying to say was ما تيعني ما تم عقيدته. What he believes is dead. Don't go to Abdurrazzaq. Those were the two views Hafiz al-Hajar mentioned, rahimahullah ta'ala, but the first view seems stronger, which is that there was a isha'a, a news that was spread, because Abdurrazzaq, even though he died, the tashayyu' that was spoken about that time is not what we know today. Are you with me, brothers? It's not what we know, but min amanat al-ilmiyah, I just mentioned that for you, inshallah ta'ala. Okay, another story is that Bukhari said, rahimahullah ta'ala, about himself. He said, دَخَلْتُ بَغْدَادَ I entered Baghdad, how many times? ثَمَانِيَ تَمَرَّاتِ How many times? Eight. How many times did I say before? When he met Imam Ahmed, did I say 14? The other narration that says 14 is more in number, so we give that precedence over the eight narration, okay? He entered 14 times Baghdad. في كلها, in all of those, أجالس أحمد بن حنبل. I will sit with Imam Ahmed بن حنبل. فقال لي, he said to me, يا أبا عبد الله. Imam al-Bukhari said to who? He said to who? Imam al-Bukhari. He said, يا أبا عبد الله, تدع العلم وتصير إلى خراسان. Because at this moment when he came to Bukhari and he took Ahmed, he wanted to go to Khurasan. So he said, are you going to leave knowledge? What does he mean knowledge? At that time, the hub for knowledge was Baghdad. Scholars were all there. Because this was the Khilafah was here. Everybody was coming here. Egypt was not a place, he said. It was a place that didn't exist. Are you with me? What did Imam Shafi'i, what did he say to his students? Abu Ya'qub al-Buayti and Ismail ibn Yahya al-Muzani and Rabi' al-Musliman al-Muradi. What did he say to them in Masr? He said, have you any one of you guys been to Iraq? And they said, no, we didn't. He said, have you ever been anywhere there? Because they were in Egypt. He said, if you guys haven't been to Iraq, have you seen the world then? Because the dunya at that time was what? Iraq. Some scholars who were in Iraq never left Iraq. Like Imam al-Ajurri, rahimahullah, sahib al-kitab al-shari'ah. He was in Iraq, remained in Iraq. He never left it. When he was asked, why did you leave Iraq? He said, where do I go? Where do you want me to go? Like, this is manba al-ilm. This is the source and the place where knowledge was. So Imam Ahmad said to Bukhari, are you going to leave ilm? Because Baghdad was ilm. Are you going to leave ilm? And then are you going to go? وَتَصِيرُ إِلَىٰ خُرَسَانِ But Bukhari just went. And then look what he said. قَالَ فَأَنَا أَذْكُرُ قَوْلَهُ الْآنِ Now what Ahmad was saying makes sense to me. Are you with me? Especially when the fitna happened between him and Yahya al-Dhuhali. He said, now I know. Now I know what Imam Ahmad was trying to say to me. Another story is, كَانَ الْبُخَارِ يَخْتَلِفُ مَعَنَا إِلَى مَشَايِخِ الْبَصْرَةِ Hashid ibn Ismail said, Bukhari used to go with us to Basra. He would go and travel with us to Basra. وَهُوَ غُلَامٌ He's young. The rest, they're senior, they're old. But he would be with them. The poet, what did he say? He said, إِذَا كَانَتِ النُّفُوسُ كِبَارًا تَعِبَتْ فِي مُرَادِهَا الْأَجْسَامُ If a person's aspirations is very high, brothers, the body will suffer to keep up with it. You are a person with high aspiration, and your mindset is high, your body may not even be equivalent to your aspiration. Are you with me, brothers? You might be younger than your age. Or you may even be what? You may even be a person who's old in age, but you still have aspiration. Are you with me? You know Joseph, what he said? Say, rahimahullah. He said, وَمَنْ تَكُنُ الْعِلْيَا هِمَّةَ نَفْسِي فَكُلُّ الَّذِي يَلْقَى فِيهِ مُحَبَّبُ Anyone, his aspiration is the sky and high above, every suffering that he endures on the way to gain knowledge, what happens to him? He enjoys it. Because it's the heart that moves the person, right? It's the heart that moves the person. So what did he say? كَانَ الْبُخَارِيُّ يَخْتَلِفُ مَعَنَا He would be with us to Basra. And I want you to understand, brothers, this is the middle of the desert. These men are walking. There's no air conditioning. There's no flight. I just landed a couple of hours ago. I came to this desert. I haven't slept for 48 hours. I'm tired. Like, I can imagine a person who wakes up, goes in the middle of that sun, and walks, and has a riding beast, and sometimes comes to their destination, and they're told, the sheikh that you wanted is dead. He died a couple of weeks ago. Or they participate in the janazah of the sheikh that they came for. And 6 months it took them to come here. 7 months it took them to come here. وَلِذَلِكَ يَحْيَ بْنُ مَعِينٍ He said, four people, they will never give you guidance. Four types of people, he said, guidance will not come to you from them. And from those four people, he said, رَجُّنُ يَقْتُبُ الْحَدِيثَ فِي بَلَدِهِ وَلَا يَرْحَلُ لِلْعِلْمِ A man who writes knowledge in his own town, in his own backyard. Yeah, Google. Yeah. And he searches on the Google engine, and then he comes out with information, not knowledge. He comes out with information, not knowledge. Not knowledge. So that type of person, he said, that you will never gain from them what? And he doesn't travel. He doesn't travel for knowledge. And Imam Ahmad rahimahullah was asked, should a person travel for knowledge? And he said, الرِّحْلَةُ فِي طَلَبِ الْعِلْمِ شَدِيدٌ نَعَمْ See, going out to seek knowledge and traveling for it. He said, Imam Ahmad said, it's great. Ibrahim al-Nakha'i and Al-Qamah ibn Abi Waqas al-Layfi and others, they would hear a hadith and they would not be happy with it unless they went to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud themselves and took it from his mouth. They would hear a narration between them and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is one person, they will say, no, I will hear it for myself. And they will travel. Are you with me? So Imam al-Bukhari at that age, he nurtured himself upon that. Are you with me, brothers? One of the ruwat that we're going to see is Sahih al-Bukhari. One of the narrators that we're going to see in Sahih al-Bukhari is, and it's one of the nusakh and the copies that we have of Sahih al-Bukhari, is the nusakh or the copy of Abu al-Waqt. Abu al-Waqt, rahimahullah, we're going to see this man. Abu al-Waqt, the reason why he was called this is he has a fascinating story. His father, when he was a young kid, his father would take him as a baby, would take him for what? Ilm al-Hadith. And his father, do you know how he would take him? He would tie his leg to the leg of his young son. And you can imagine a father taking a step, and a young kid taking the same step as his father. What's going to happen? He'll drag him. And he'll also give him two rocks. And so hold those two rocks. Whenever he gets tired, he'll say, pass me one of the rocks. He'll throw away. He'll say, hold the other rock. And then when they get, give me the other rock. Take it away. Now they call that child abuse. Yeah? Social services will stomp your house and stuff like that. I'm not endorsing that, by the way. I'm just talking about tarjama, biography. So Abu al-Waqt, rahimahullah, and then after that, when he got tired and he couldn't keep up with his father would place him on the shoulder. And he became a man known for the diligence of his time. Are you any brothers? Nurturing a child at a young age. Just nurturing him. And his nuskha and his copy is Bukhari. We have it today. It's one of the nuskha when we speak about. And the copies of Bukhari, inshallah ta'ala, will touch on. بِإِبْنِ اللَّهِ الْبَارِي. So Bukhari went with us. فَلَا يَكْتُبْ. Bukhari would not write. He wouldn't write. حَتَّى أَتَى عَلَى ذَلِكَ أَيَّامٌ. Days went by. He's going to the mashayikh, he's with the shuyukh, he's with the teachers, and they're traveling, and they're going to a shaykh, and they're listening, and they're all writing, and he's not writing anything. So they started saying, what are you doing? Why are you wasting your time? Why are you sitting around? You traveled, you left your hometown, and you're not writing anything. Where's the pen? What the scholars, they say that al-ilmu saydun wal-kitabatu qayduhu. قيد حبالك بالوثائق بالحبال الواثق إن فإن من الحماقة أن تصيد غزالة وتتركها بين الخلائق طالقة. Knowledge is like hunting. It's like what?
Hunting.
Okay. The way to keep it, to keep knowledge down, the rope to use is pen. Is a pen. So when you knowledge, it's like somebody throwing at you so much things. It's like so much. In order to grab that knowledge, the way you do it is with a pen. فَإِنَّ مِنَ الْحَمَاقَةِ What is dimwittedness is that you hunt a غَزَالَ, a deer or an animal, you hunt it. And guess what you do? After you hunt it, you bring it home and you just let it walk around. صح? In other words, you went to seek knowledge and you sat with a sheikh and the knowledge was thrown at you and you do, guess what you're doing? You're not holding it down with the book. But like in Bukhari, he wouldn't do that. He would come and he would sit down. And he would listen. فَلُمْنَاهُ We started blaming him and criticizing him. فَقَالَ لَنَا بَعْدَ سِتَّةَ عَشَرَ يَوْمًا After 16 days of blaming and criticism and them saying, why are you not writing? He said to them, قَدْ كَثَرْتُمْ عَلَيَّ You have criticized me excessively, all of you guys. فَعَلُضُوا عَلَيَّ مَا كَثَرْتُمْ Present to me what you all wrote. فَأَخْرَجْنَاهُ We all brought our copies out and where we wrote it in. فَزَادَ عَلَى فأخرجناه. He listened to every one of them what they wrote. And when he listened to each and every one of theirs, he mentioned a hadith that they missed, 15,000 hadith that they missed. He increased it onto it. فقرأها كلها عن ظهر القلب. All of it, he what? Read it from memory. So it seems that what they wrote was correct, but they didn't have the different turuq that he had from elsewhere. Are you with me, brothers? When we come to his hifz, we haven't spoken about his hifz yet. We have not touched on Imam al-Bukhari's hifz yet. We're going to come to it, what he was, and the things that he did. When he read all of that, حَتَّى جَعَلْنَا نُحْكِمُ كُتُبَنَا مِنْ حِفْظِهِ When we realize this man, what he is something different. We all brought our books out and we said, are we right? Did I write this right? We would judge our books based on his memory. فَعَلِمْنَا أَنَّهُ لَا يَتَقَدَّمُهُ أَحَدٍ We realized no one is going to go before this man. فَكَانَ أَهْلُ الْمَعْرِفَةِ بِالْبَصْرَةِ The people of insight and knowledge in Basra يَعُدُّونَ خَلْفَهُ فِي طَلَبِ الْعِلْمِ They stood behind him in seeking knowledge of hadith. فَيَكْتُبُونَ عَنْهُ They started to write from him. وَهُوَ شَابٌ A young kid. حَتَّى يَغْلِبُوهُ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ They used to push him over themselves. وَيُجْلِسُونَهُ فِي بَعْضِ الطَّرِيقِ And some of their lessons, when they saw him, they would say, sit here. Some of the ulama, whenever Bukhari would walk into the gathering, they would shave shiva. We'll see that later, inshallah ta'ala. They didn't like, they used to worry of his sitting. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. Now we're going to go into his hifz, inshallah ta'ala. The next chapter is what? Hifzihi wa nabahatihi. وَالسَّيَلَانُ ذِهْنِهِ Let's now talk about Bukhari's Hifd. How is he like in terms of Hifd? Listen to this story. It's a very common, famous story. A lot of people already know it. Like, let's just mention it. It's of benefit. We'll start with that, inshallah ta'ala. Ahmad ibn Adi, he said, I heard some of the mashayikh mention that Muhammad ibn Ismail qadima Baghdad. Where did he come to? He came to Baghdad. فَسَمِعَ بِهِ أَصْحَابُ الْحَدِيثِ. The people of Hadith heard from him. فَاجْتَمَعُوا وَعَمَدُوا إِلَى مِئَةَ حَدِيثٍ. And Imam Bukhari, he came to, rahimahullah ta'ala, Baghdad. When he came to Baghdad, he narrated, he gave a hadith, he taught. A group of the people of Hadith thought, we want to know if Bukhari is Bukhari. I want to know if this man is what he's, what's said about him. And scholars, they used to get tested. There was something called فُلَانُ يَقْبَلُ التَّلْقِينَ. So-and-so, he accepts talqeen, means if anything is told to him, he says, yeah, that's my narration, when it isn't his narration. So they used to test scholars' hifd and their memorization in order to know, especially if the person is attributed to him, that he has what? Hifd. They used to test him. This was the time of what? The time when documentation and narrations were being written. So Bukhari, rahimahullah, they wanted to test him. فَاجْتَمَعُوا وَعَمَدُوا إِلَى مِئَةَ حَدِيثٍ. They picked 100 hadiths. Are you with me, brothers? فَقَلَبُوا مُتُونَهَا وَأَسَانِيدَهَا. 10 of them sat together and they said, let's divide the hadith into how much? Into 10. Each one 10. And we're going to take it. Everybody crossed the wording of the hadith and the senate, you take my chain, I take the hadith from you. And they twisted it. They did maqloob to the matan and the hadith. Are you with me, brothers? For me, it doesn't fascinate me, or it does amaze me, but what amazed me more is how he remembered who said it. This is the part that shocked me the most. So what did Bukhari rahimahullah do? Listen to the story, they spread it amongst themselves and they went around him in circle. He listened. The first man, he threw the hadith at Imam al-Bukhari and he said to him, do you know it? Imam al-Bukhari said, La a'rifu, I don't know it. And they looked at each other. Bukhari doesn't know. Each man went through the chain. Each man mentioned his one. Finish. Every time he keeps saying, La a'rifu, I don't know it, I don't know it, I don't know this. I don't know this, I don't know this, I don't... Everyone, he said. They were looking. 100 hadiths went through. Bukhari does not know any of them. When they finished, Imam al-Bukhari, he said to them, you, all of the hadith that you mentioned, this is the chain for it. And your chains are with Fulan. Take it from him. And your other chain was with Fulan. And your other chain is there. And the matan of that hadith is with there. And he named the people who had the chain, and if the chain was with that person, he would say, that's your chain. Take it from him. What fascinated me is the fact that he remembered each person. Knowing the chain was already there for him. The hadith was already there. This is when they stood up and they looked at him and said, no. Keeping in mind, this man is from Uzbekistan. He's a what? He's not an Arab. This man's not an Arab. He's a non-Arab. They became fascinated and shocked with what Imam al-Bukhari did. This was a famous story of his. And Hafiz al-Hajr said, هنا يخضع للبخاري. Here is where people humble themselves for Bukhari. In front of him. And he deserves to be called Amir al-Mu'mineen fil hadith. فما العجب. Hafiz al-Hajr said, what fascination is? من رد الخطأ إلى الصواب بل العجب من حفظ الخطأ على ترتيب ما ألقوه عليه من مرة واحدة. Each person, remember, they read it once, not twice. There was no repetition. What he did was he gave everybody their chain. Crossed it. Yours, this is yours, this is yours. And what's even more shocking is he did it in the order that they did it. He didn't change the order. He went according to their order. And he never wrote it. They picked the hadiths. They did the order, they came up with the narrations, they picked the people who were going to do this, and he answered them in the order that they gave. Hafiz ibn Hajar is fascinated. Who's Hafiz ibn Hajar? Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Fascinated with the story of Al-Imam al-Bukhari's memorization and how he was in terms of his hifz. Another story. This story is mentioned by Muhammad ibn Ibrahim al-Daghuniyu rahimahullah. He said, سَمِعْتُ يُوسُفِ ibn Musa al-Marudhiyu saying, كُنْتُ بِالْبَصْرَةِ I was in Basra, فِي جَامِعَهَا in one of its jamias, masajids. إِذْ سَمِعْتُ مُنَادِيًا يُنَادِي I heard a caller call out. Somebody called out. Ya ahl al-ilm, people of knowledge, laqad qadima Muhammad ibn Ismail. Muhammad Ismail al-Bukhari has entered, has come. Faqamu fi talabi. Oh people, Bukhari has entered the city. Everyone come. Somebody said that. They all heard that. They charged at Imam al-Bukhari. Fasalla, Bukhari came in. When they came in, Bukhari was praying under a pillar. He was praying behind a فَصَلَّى خَلْفَ أُسْطُوَانَ under a pillar. Salah. Finished the salah. When he finished, they فَأَجَابَهُمْ إِلَىٰ ذَلِكَ They said, Shaykh, we called out amongst ourselves and we wanted you to inshallah ta'ala give us some ahadith. Al-Imam al-Bukhari, he said, okay, no problem. You want me to narrate some ahadith for you? You want me to give you some narrations? He said, no problem. Let's set a majlis al-imla, a gathering where I dictate the hadith for you. He said, let's make it tomorrow. They said, okay. فَلَمَّا أَنْ كَانَ بِالْغَدَاءَةِ When the next day came, حَضَرَ الْفُقَهَاءِ وَالْمُحَدِّثُونَ People became even more. Now they know Bukhari's got a gathering. Everybody, the numbers became even more. The fuqaha, they came. The muhaddithun, they came. The huffaz, everyone came. حَتَّى اجْتَمَعَ Until the gathering became ألف نفس 1,000 people came. فجلس أبو عبد الله بالإملاء. Bukhari sat down to narrate and mention. Before he started dictating the hadith, he said to them, يا أهل بصرة, or people of بصرة, أنا شاب, I'm a young man. وقد سألتموني أن أحدثكم, and you've all requested for me to narrate for you. وسأحدثكم, and I will do that for you. I will narrate for you. بأحاديث عن أهل بلدكم I will tell you all of the hadith of the people of Basra بس. The narrations of what? أهل Basra Because you are from the people of Basra That's what I'll give you guys تستفيدون It will benefit you guys a lot ليست عند أحد منكم None of you have it from amongst you Imagine you can say that 1,000 فقهاء محدثون حفاظ I'm going to give you a hadith of your own city And none of you have it. Then they said to us, they said to him, tell us those ahadiths, Bukhari. The people were first of all fascinated with that statement of his. Then they said, okay, let's see it. And then he said, حدثنا عبد الله بن عثمان بن حجاب الأتى رحمه الله. And then he mentioned his chain and he started to narrate رحمه الله تعالى. Every time he would narrate, he would say, رحمه الله تعالى فلان هذا الحديث عند كذا وكذا فأما من رواية فلان so and so with him is this chain and so is with this chain and none of you have it take this down and when he would say that no one has it everyone would look and look at each other like somebody might say I have it no one would say it everyone would say okay, it's true I don't have it just write it down that fascinated me this other story fascinated me as well Ishaq ibn Rahuya came to visit Bukhari when he was sick. Ishaq ibn Rahuya, you know him, right? If you don't know Ishaq ibn Rahuya, Ishaq ibn Rahuya is the one who brought the idea, we're going to speak about him later, to Bukhari to author his Sahih. And he's the teacher of Bukhari, by the way. He's Bukhari's teacher. He came and visited Bukhari while he was on his, while he was sick. So when he visited him, and this is in the month of Ramadan, he said to him, Aftarta ya Aba Abdullah. It's Ramadan, you're sick. Did you break your fast? فقلت نعم, I said, yes, I did. فقال خشيت أن تضعف عن قبول الرخصة. I was fear and scared that you may weaken the opinion that you can take the rukhsa, that you can leave it fasting. And then he said to him, Al-Imam al-Bukhari, أخبرنا عبدان عن ابن مبارك عن ابن جريج قال قلت لعطاء من أي المرض أفطر قال من أي مرض كان كما قال الله عز وجل فمن كان منكم مريضا He brought a chain that you're allowed to break your fasting when you're sick. Qala al-Bukhari, Bukhari straight away, this is what shocked me the most. Honestly, this is what shocked me the most. And he looked at Ishaq ibn Rahuya and he said to him, لَمْ يَكُنْ هَذَا عِنْدَكَ يَا أَبَا إِسْحَاقَ لَمْ يَكُنْ عِنْدَكَ هَذَا يَا أَبَا إِسْحَاقَ كَمَا لَمْ يَكُنْ عِنْدَكَ هَذَا إِسْحَاقَ إِسْحَاق, this is not with you. You don't have this chain. You don't have this hadith. That's his own teacher. This is a hadith you don't have. And then Ishaq said, صَدَقْتَ, you have told the truth. What shocked me the most now is the benefit that I took from this. That Bukhari knew every one hadith that they knew. It's another mizah. How can you come to a gathering, look at the people's faces, and say none of you have this chain? Because he would be lying if he said that. And that would put his status down. Are you with me, brothers? Bukhari will not be taking his hadith then. He'll be a liar to say this to people. Are you with me, brothers? He actually did isti'ab to actually know the hadith that were present with Fulan, hadith that were present with Fulan, and hadith that were present with Fulan. This is a what? This is a mizah, wallahi. This is shocking. I don't know if anything after that a person can say to you about a person's memorization. That's powerful in terms of memory. Should we carry on more or should we just move on to the next point? Let's move on to the next point. I'll choose that for you. Because there's too much points that Ibn Hajar mentioned in Hadith Sari. Al-Imam al-Bukhari was rahalat, his journeys. We mentioned it before, like, and we went over it fast. Let's mention where he traveled to. Al-Imam al-Bukhari, he said, لَقِيْتُ I met أَكْثَرَ مِنْ أَلْفِ شَيْخٍ. I met how many sheikhs? More than 1,000. مِنْ أَهْلِ الْحِجَازِ, from Ahl al-Hijaz. So he traveled to Hijaz. Hijaz is what? Makan? Medina. Basra. He went to Wasit. Baghdad. Sham. And Egypt. And he went to Jazeera. Now he mentions how many times he went to places. Jazeera, he said, I went there twice. Basra, he said, I went there 4 times. Hijaz, he said, I went there 6 years. So scholars, they said 6 years means he's 6 different times he went. Hijaz. Naam, Hijaz. He said, وَلَا أَدْرِي كَمْ دَخَلْتُ كُوفَةُ وَبَغْدَادِ. I don't know how many times I went to Kufa and Baghdad. That's not in my number. I don't remember that. It's too much. So if it has to be more than 6, right? Because he said that Hijaz is 6. Are you with me, brothers? So it has to be more than 6, correct? Take a calendar and get an atlas at home and look at those places. Cross them by. That is like he spent his whole life on the road. What did he spend? And this, brothers, what does it make us feel? How this deen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has been protected and is being taken care of by these scholars. Now we're going to go to his shuyukh. What are we going to go into? The shuyukh of Imam al-Bukhari. I'm going to give you a benefit, inshallah ta'ala, in terms of shuyukh of Bukhari. I like what Hafiz ibn Hajar did when it came to the shuyukh of Imam al-Bukhari. He broke the shuyukh of Imam al-Bukhari into 5 levels. Let me mention the names and then I'll break the levels. I'll break into the levels. Some of his shuyukh are Makki ibn Ibrahim al-Balkhi, Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn, Musaddad ibn Musarhad al-Basri, Ali ibn Abdullah al-Madini, rahimahullah, Ishaq ibn Ibrahim al-Hanbari, who is known as Ishaq ibn Rahuya, Abu Raja, Qutaybah ibn Sa'id al-Baghlani, al-Imam Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah, and Ahmad ibn Salih al-Misri, and Muhammad ibn al-Muthanna, who is well known as Bizzaman, and also Muhammad ibn Bashar ibn Bandar, rahimahullah ta'ala. Those are like 10 of his shuluks. I don't want you to busy yourself with knowing the names. Just learn the levels. That's more beneficial for you. And you can note, you can take the names at the ending, inshallah ta'ala, when I answer the questions for you, I'll give it to you again, inshallah ta'ala. The students of Imam, the shuyukh of Bukhari are 5 levels. Please know this, because now we're going into the knowledge of the book. The levels of the shuyukhs of Bukhari are 5 levels. Number one, is man haddathahu an tabi'in. He took from who? the tabi'in. من حدثه عن التابعين the tabi'in that he took from. That's Makki ibn Ibrahim and Muhammad ibn Abdullah al-Ansari and Ubaydullah ibn Musa and Abi Asim al-Nabil and Abu Nu'aym al-Mullai and Abu al-Mughira al-Khawlani and Khalad ibn Yahya وغيرهم and other than them. Listen, don't remember that, don't have to force yourself memorizing the names now. The first one is the tabi'in that he took from. Number two, من كان في عصر هؤلاء وتأخر عنهم. Those who, in which he was, same era, same asr, same timing. Or they were in the same timing of those which were mentioned, the tabi'in. وتأخر عنهم, and he came late on them. And Imam al-Bukhari came late to them. Such as Adib ibn Abi Iyas al-Asqalani, Abi Mushir ibn Abd al-A'la ibn Mushir, Ayyub ibn Sulaiman ibn Bilal, Hajjaj ibn Minhal, Sa'id ibn Abi Maryam, Thabit ibn Muhammad al-Zahid, and other than them. Number three. أوصاط مشايخ الذين شاركه في الرواية عنهم مسلم وغيره. The second one are awsatu mashayikhi, the middle student, his shuyukhs, the middle ones, the high level ones, which were the tabi'i, like now he has a middle one.
The second or third?
Third one. We're now in the third one. The third one are awsatu mashayikhi, the shuyukhs that are in the middle. Why do we say in the middle? Because other students of his shared these people with him. Like Imam Muslim narrated these people with him. Are you with me? These shuyukh are in the wasat, in the middle. Bukhari and Muslim and others shared these ahadith with him. And these are Ahmad ibn Hanbal and Ishaq ibn Rahuya and Yahya ibn Ma'in and Ibn Abi Shayba and Qutaybah ibn Sa'id and Ali ibn al-Madini and others and Nu'aym ibn Hamad al-Khuza'i and other than them. These people, Bukhari narrated from it, and also others narrated with him on these ones. Number four.
So you remember level one and two, is it specific that Imam Bukhari narrated
from them? Ha, these are unique to him. Okay. Ah, because of his senior age, na'am. I mean, when we say, in comparison to the six books, you mean, right?
Yes.
Ah, sahih. Number four. رُفَقَاؤُهُ فِي الطَّلَبُ وَقُرَنَاؤُهُ فِي الْحَدِيثِ. His contemporaries, he's the people who he is level to, that he narrated from. That's your sheikh. If you narrate from him and he narrates from you, it becomes what? Riwayat al-Aqran, right? We study that in Mustalah, right? Riwayat al-Aqran means people narrating from one another. We're students together, but there's a hadith missing from me and you have that hadith. If you give it to me, you're my sheikh. You're listed as my sheikh. Are you with me? Even if we are students together. From those people is Muhammad ibn Yahya al-Duhali. Muhammad ibn Yahya al-Duhali and Bukhari are what? They're contemporaries, the Qurana. But Bukhari narrated from him. As I mentioned in his Sahih, right? Abi Hatim al-Razi, Abu Zur'at al-Razi, all of these are Al-Imam al-Darimi, Abdullah ibn Humayt, Ahmad ibn al-Nasr, Muhammad ibn Ismail, Muhammad ibn Rahim, sorry. And other than them, they were students of the shuyukhs of Bukhari. So they were his contemporaries. But he narrated from them as well. He felt that they had narrations that he needed and they were reliable, he took it from them. Number five, which are the last ones, Bukhari students. قَوْمٌ فِي عِدَادِ طَلَبَتِهِ فِي السِّنِ وَالْإِسْنَادِ. They're his students, they're considered to be his students. Like Abdullah ibn Hamad al-Ummiliyu. وحسين بن محمد القباني وعبد الله بن أبي القاضي ومحمد بن إسحاق السراج وأبي عيسى محمد بن عيسى الترمذي. الترمذي is Bukhari's wife. Are you with me? But you find one hadith of Tirmidhi in what? Bukhari. صحيح, right? Bukhari narrated from him. Tirmidhi was happy. He's like, oh, Bukhari narrated from me. But that's one hadith. Now, Tirmidhi is what? Tirmidhi is what? Student of who? Or he's of the level of the students of Bukhari. This shows us the humility and humbleness of these great scholars. Are you with me, brothers? These scholars, they were what? They were what? They gave weight to their students' view. If their students knew, they'll say, I took this person from them. Knowledge was not lost. It wasn't, I am the sheikh, everyone has to listen to me. Submit! Yeah? And everyone has to listen. It's not like that. What is it? Knowledge between the people, it's a lost property of the... It's a lost property of the believer. There's a line of poetry I mentioned before. I never mentioned it here, somewhere else I mentioned it. That Imam Ibn Malik in his Alfiyah, he's an Imam in grammar himself. He has his own kiyana, he has his own weight. Are you with me? But then he felt the necessity of quoting a student of his in his gathering and say that this is the view of my student. And that student is Imam Nawawi. ولا يجوز الابتداء بالنكرة ما لم يفيدك عند زيد النمرة وهل فتن فيكم فما خل لنا ورجل من الكرام عندنا. Who does he mean, ورجل من الكرام عندنا؟ Imam Nawawi. He's mentioning his view, and then after that, what does he say? But an honorable man from within our gathering, Nawawi, doesn't hold that view. And Nawawi at that time is very young, especially very, very young. So it shows you that they would take into consideration of taking from their students if they had something to offer. That's the shuyukh of Al-Imam al-Bukhari. Now we're going to go into the students of Al-Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah. We're going to go into the most common and most well-known students. By the way, Bukhari students are too much. How do we know it's too much? Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Firabri, Muhammad ibn Yusuf ibn Matar al-Firabri, who we're going to later look at, is one of the ruwat of, Sahih. We're going to touch on him later. Muhammad ibn Yusuf ibn Matar al-Firabri, I'm a Farabri. You can say it both ways. He said that the people who heard the Sahih from Bukhari is 90,000 people. How many people did he say that heard the Sahih from Bukhari? 90,000, that's all his students. Are you with me, brothers? Does that make sense? Brothers, pay attention here. 90,000 people narrated the Sahih from Bukhari. When he dictated this hadith, 90,000 people heard it from him. He says that, rahimahullah ta'ala. So if we say, which is correct, سمعنا على محمد بن إسماعيل. He said, سمع صحيح البخاري لمحمد بن إسماعيل 90,000 رجل. 90,000 men. فما بقي أحد يرويه غيري. We're going to come to that later, inshallah ta'ala. But does that make sense to everybody? Muhammad ibn Yusuf ibn Matar al-Firabri saying 90,000 heard Sahih al-Bukhari from him. He's Sahih. Can we put a number to his students then? No. We can't. But that also brings us another benefit that we can take from here, is that the students, how they love knowledge at that time. 90,000. Can a person have 90,000 students today? They're all on Instagram. And Twitter and Facebook. Huh? They're not in gatherings and seeking knowledge. Sah? Are you here? Not that I'm saying everybody doesn't seek knowledge. But I mean the greatest numbers and the greatest amount is elsewhere. And they weren't at the gatherings of the people of knowledge. They weren't. But we'll mention some prominent students of his. We'll use that word. We'll say, Ashharu Talamidi Imam al-Bukhari. Bukhari's well-known, prominent students. Those who we know. Number one is al-Imam Muslim ibn Hajjaj, who died the year 261. The second one is Abu Zur'ata al-Razi. Abu Zur'ata al-Razi. Abu Hatim al-Raziyu. So Abu Zur'ata al-Razi and who? Abu Hatim al-Razi. Number four is Al-Imam Tirmidhi. And the fifth one is Al-Imam Ibn Abi Dunya. Imam Ibn Abi al-Dunya. Number six is who? Al-Imam al-Nasa'iyu. Number seven is Al-Imam Ibn Khuzaymah, rahimahullah ta'ala. Those are the seven that are prominent, that are all from the students of Al-Imam al-Bukhari. Number one is Imam Muslim, Abu Zur'at al-Razi, Abu Hatim al-Razi, Al-Imam al-Tirmidhi, Ibn Abi Dunya, Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, and Imam Ibn Khuzaymah. There are many more, but we'll just stop there, inshallah ta'ala, for that. Now we're going to go into Imam al-Bukhari's works. We're going to touch on what? Imam al-Bukhari is what? The works and the books that he wrote. The first book that we mention is what? Al-Jami' al-Sahih. The book that he's sahih. But we won't talk about that. We're going to come to that. That's the whole chapter. We won't go into that now. His Jami' al-Sahih is coming soon. But that's one of his books. The second book that he wrote is Adab al-Mufrad. He has a book called what? Al-Adab al-Mufrad. What does this book deal with? It deals with akhlaq and also what taqweem and to correct your suluk. The way you carry yourself, your manners, your etiquette. That book is something a student of knowledge should give time out to study. Number three is he has a kitab called At-Tariq al-Kabir. Tariq al-Kabir. This kitab, Tariq al-Kabir, is a mawsu'a, it's an encyclopedia. Okay? In what, like in fit-tarajum, biographies. And he organized this book, rahimahullah, the names of the narrators of hadith who are in there alphabetically. So who is the first person who's going to be there? Aban. Alif, Ba, that's the first name. When you open the book, it's alphabetically. Alif is the first letter. What comes after it? Ba. So he will write, the book is written. Okay? And the people he mentions there in there is Sahaba and Tabi'een and everyone that came to his time. Are you with me? Everybody at his particular time. It's a big book. Then what he felt was, he had to write another tariq. He wrote another second tariq, which is book number four. He called it Tariq al-Awsat. Tariq al-Awsat, he started with the hijrah from Abyssinia. That's where he started from. And he mentioned some of the Prophet's biography also in there. And he spoke about the Sahabas who died at the time of the Prophet. And then he mentioned the companions at the time who died at the time of the Khulafa al-Rashideen. And then he spoke about the narrators and their information when they were born, when they died. And that kitab is published and it's present. It's published. The fifth book that he authored is Tariq al-Saghir. Tariq al-Saghir is specific to the companions only. And this was the first book ever written. Number six is called Al-Du'afa al-Kabir. Al-Du'afa al-Kabir, Bukhari wrote this book and he went in great details in mentioning the weak narrators. Number seven, he authored another kitab called Al-Du'afa al-Saghir. Al-Du'afa al-Saghir, where he talks about the weak narrators, but this time he speaks about them bitarajum qasira, in short. It doesn't go in like he did before, where he, some of the tarajum is a page. Even that the person's weak, he goes a page. Like in his du'afa al-saghir, he goes less. Number eight is khalq af'al al-ibad. This kitab khalq af'al al-ibad, Bukhari rahimahullah, he wrote that book after the allegation and the accusation that was put onto him regarding that the Quran is created. The fitna that we spoke about, the fitna of Muhammad ibn Yahya, al-Dhuhri al-Bukhari. So he wrote that book to prove that the Quran is the speech of who? Speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that it's not created. And he refuted in that book as well who? The Jahmiyyah and the Mu'tazila. The ninth book that he wrote was Raf'ul Yadayni fi Salah. The raising of the hand in the Salah, and he was refuting who? The Hanafis. How many fitna did I say that happened to Bukhari? Two fitna, right? Fitna two? The fitna of issue of Khalq al-Quran, and the other one was what? The Wali Bukhara, sah? The governor of Bukhara. I forgot to mention the Hanafis, they gave him a hard time as well. They threw their little, huh? The Hanafis, the third group, they gave him another problem. When the issue of Iraq happened and the fitna took place, the Ahnaf, they saw this as an opportunity and they were large in number. Are you with me? They were what? They were large in number. So then they used this as an opportunity because he wrote a kitab called Raf'ul Yadayn, the raising of the hands, and he was refuting them. He was refuting them. So he brought all of the riwayat and the ahadith that speak about the raising of the hands and that it's a sunnah thabita, a correctly transmitted sunnah. So the Hanafis, they gave him a hard time. Now they say they like him. Number 10. Yeah? Number 10, he wrote Juz'ul Qira'ati Khalf al-Imam. Again, who is he refuting again here? the Hanafis again. On the issue of reading Fatiha behind the Imam. Rather, they believe you don't have to read anything because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ. If the Quran is Imam is reading in the Salah, you don't have to read anything, you just listen. So they believe you don't even need to read Fatiha at all. Are you with me, brothers? He refuted them in that book and he spoke about وُجُوبُ قِرَاءَةِ الْقُرْآنِ behind the Imam, and he also spoke about reciting Surah Al-Fatiha. Reciting Surah Al-Fatiha. And the opinion that Bukhari mentioned in that book of his is that if you reach the Imam when he's in ruku', you do not consider that to be a rak'ah. You have to come back because you never recited Fatiha. And that opinion is the strongest. That if you reach the Imam in ruku', don't consider that to be a rak'ah. What does it consider it? That's not a rak'ah for you. You have to bring that rak'ah back because you never read Fatiha. And that's the opinion held by Imam Bukhari and Abu Hurairah, who narrated the hadith of قَسَمْتُ صَلَاتِ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي نِصْفَيْنِ, the issue of Fatiha. And also the hadith of Prophet ﷺ, لَا صَلَاتَ لِمَنْ لَمْ يَقْرَ بِفَاتِحَةِ الْكِتَابِ, Ubadah ibn Samit, and Abu Hurairah, I think, narrated as well. Are you with me, brothers? As for the hadith that says, إِذَا مَنْ أَدْرَكَ الْإِمَامُ رَاكِعًا فَقَدْ أَدْرَكَ الرَّكْعَةِ, anyone who reaches the Imam in ruku', then he has reached the rak'ah. It means anyone who reaches the Imam in ruku', he has reached the salah. Not that he reached that particular rak'ah. Why? Because فَقَدْ أَدْرَكَ الرَّكْعَةِ, sometimes a portion of the prayer may be used for the whole prayer. قِيَامُ اللَّيْلِ is it only a stand? It has ruku', it has sujood. Why did Allah say, Inna Rabbaka ya'lamu annaka taqumu? So when the Prophet ﷺ said, Man adraka al-imam al-raki'a, faqad adraka al-raka'a, faqad adraka al-salah. He has reached. Why are we saying that's what it means? Because we have to bring two of the hadith together, which is, La salata liman lam yaqra bi fatihati al-kitab, in this hadith. And the qa'idah is, as Abdullah ibn Hajj al-Shanqiti said in his kitab, Maraqi al-Su'ud, Wal jam'u wajibun mata ma amkana, إلا فلل أخير نسخ بينا والجمع واجب متى ما أمكن إلا فلل أخير نسخ بينا. That to bring the two hadith together takes precedence, then disregarding one. The one who says that if you reach the Imam in ruku', he is disregarding which hadith? He's disregarding the hadith of Prophet ﷺ, لا صلاة إلا من لم يقرأ بفاتحة الكتاب. He's disregarding it. So the only way is to combine the two by mentioning that explanation. We have, inshallah ta'ala, spoken about the books of Imam al-Bukhari. We're going to now conclude with the praise that the scholars put to Imam al-Bukhari. We're not going to go too much into that one. The praise that the scholars praise him.
Can you repeat the books again?
So the first one is, he's sahih. And we'll speak about that, inshallah ta'ala. The second one is Adab al-Mufrad. Number three is Tariq al-Kabir. Number four is At-Tariq al-Awsat. Five, Tariq al-Saghir. Six, Al-Du'afa al-Kabir. Al-Du'afa al-Saghir, خلق أفعال العباد, رفع اليدين في الصلاة, جزء القراءة خلف الإمام. And, did I say it right?
Yes.
Those were the ten. That doesn't mean that's only books he wrote, but these are we're always talking about the most prominent books of his. We can spend time of speaking about each book, what publication is the best, which one can you get, who did the tahqiq of it, we can compare the copies, but that's too long. The only book that we're going to do that with is what? The Sahih. The Sahih, we're going to speak about the copies and the narrations of it, and we'll speak about it in more details, inshallah ta'ala. I hope that the time doesn't finish before we go into that. And if we do go over, then this defeats the purpose of why this whole... The whole, for me, it wasn't the biography of Bukhari, rahimahullah, necessarily. It's his sahih. Mm-hmm. Let's conclude the last point before we go for the salah. مَكَانَتُهُ وَثَنَاءُ الْعُلَمَاءِ عَلَيْهِ, the praise that the scholars put towards Imam al-Bukhari. How the scholars praised him. I don't know who I. Qutaybah ibn Sa'id, which is the shuyukh of Bukhari, I want to mention his teachers, because a student can praise you, or your friend can praise you. Like when your teacher praises you, that's amazing. Bukhari's teacher, Sa'id, Qutaybah ibn Sa'id, he said, لو كان محمد بن إسماعيل في الصحابة لكان آية. If Bukhari was with the companions, and he was with them, he would have been amazement towards them as well. They would have been amazed with him. That's something big. Are you with me, brothers? That would have been, some scholars, they went overboard by saying, if, some scholars went overboard. They said, if Bukhari was a prophet, then his miracle would have been his sahih. If he was. And I said, some scholars said, and there's not extreme in that, like in that means the quwwah of, and the praise of the scholars, they went over towards him. Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Hamadani, he said, كُنَّا عِنْدَ قُتَيْبَةِ ibn Sa'id. A man came to him whose name was called Abu Ya'qub. He asked him about Muhammad ibn Ismail al-Bukhari. He said, what do you think about him? فَقَالَ he said, يَا هَؤُلَاءِ, O people, نَظَرْتُ فِي الْحَدِيثِ, I looked at hadith. وَنَظَرْتُ فِي الرَّأِي, I looked at opinions. وَجَالَسْتُ الْفُقَهَاءِ وَالزُّهَادِ وَالْعُبَّادِ, I sat with the jurists, I sat with the aesthetic scholars, I sat with the worshippers of Allah. مَا رَأَيْتُ مُنْذُ عَقِلْتُ, I did not see since the day I had aql, مِثْلَ مُحَمَّدِ ibn Ismail al-Bukhari. No one like him. Okay, pay attention. This is his shuyukh, Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Hamadani. He said, I sat with scholars, from the day I had aql, I'm counting it from there, the day I can tell the difference between the people, from that day till now, I haven't seen anyone like Bukhari in what? Hadith, ra'i, opinions, fiqh, zuhd, and ibadah. I wish I could mention some of the ibadat of Imam al-Bukhari, lakin we don't have that much time. I'm going to conclude with it. I'm going to conclude with his final quote of Muhammad ibn Salam al-Baykandi, rahimahullah. Muhammad ibn Salam al-Baykandi, he said, كُلَّمَا دَخَلَ عَلَيَّ الْبُخَارِيُ, every time Bukhari entered onto me, تَحَيَّرْتُ, I get confused. I don't know where I am. وَلَا أَزَالُ خَائِفًا مِنْهُ, I always fear him. And Bukhari was only 16. Whenever he would come into my gathering, I would become very nervous. And I would be what? I would be scared of him. I would be scared of him. And he's the sheikh that I told you that he presented his sahih, his books to him, and he said, correct it for me. And then he would say, رضي الفتى لم يرضى الفتى. Muhammad ibn Salam al-Baykandi, rahimahullah. I will leave it there, inshallah. There are many other, you all can, inshallah ta'ala, find a lot of the scholars, what they said about him. I went after the salah to go into the sahih, inshallah ta'ala.